Hello everybody, my name is Tolomira Dimitrova and today we are going to continue with the second lecture from the fourth module of Compax project, Business Development and Fundraising. And today we are going to speak about business planning and strategy. In this lecture, we are going to present the main contents of business plan and strategy, when these documents are being used, what are their purposes, and why are they essential for the successful running of a company. I would like to remind you again that if you have any questions, you should write them down and send it to me so that I can respond to them in the beginning of our next meeting. The first type of document which we are going to discuss is the strategy. The term strategy is derived indirectly from the classic and Byzantine Greek strategos, which means general. While the term is credited to the Greeks, no Greek ever used that word. The Greek equivalent for the modern word strategy would have been strategike episteme, or generous knowledge, or strategon sophia, generous wisdom. One of the most famous Latin words in the area of military strategy is written by Frontius and has the Greek title strategemata. Strategemata describes a compilation of strategema or strategems, which are literally tricks of war. The Roman historians also introduced the term strategia to refer territories under control of strategicus, a military commander in ancient Athens and a member of the Council of War. The word retained this narrow geographic meaning until Count Gilbert, a French military thinker, introduced the term la strategique in 1799, in the sense that this is understood today. Consequentially, neither the military community before Count Gilbert nor the business community before Igor Ansev could see the strategic element in their domains clearly enough to divide it with a name. Perhaps the military figure with the most impact on strategy is Karl von Clausewitz. Clausewitz was a Prussian general who worked entitled On War, is probably the most famous treatise ever on the subject. Clausewitz focused on two questions. What is war? And what purpose does it serve? The Prussian general viewed war as a duel between two independent minds. Clausewitz's key to strategy was to always be strong, first overall and then at the decisive point. Whereas the Chinese philosophy was the use of minimum force with a greater emphasis of trickery, Clausewitz recommended the use of maximum force whenever possible. Most military thought leaders agree that many years from now, it will be the Chinese and Clausewitz's writings on military strategy that will have stood the test of time. The reason why we are including this information in the lecture is to present the relation and the similarities between the military understanding of strategy and its business interpretation. In both cases, it is very important to understand that the plan is the path of actions for a particular battle, but the notion of strategy is related to the war itself. Interrelated in today's language, the business plan is concerned with the specific actions of your company and the strategy, with the vision and goals of its existence.
There are some main components of the strategy. The strategy has a unique structure, and if you overlook one of the five key elements of the structure, you will fail. Add elements that don't support the structure and you will fail. And the failure will look familiar every time. The reason is that even though it may seem chaotic, actually in each and every strategy there are certain steps and elements you need to follow, and this is a must. The first element is power distribution. The power distribution is mainly related with the access to information. Who in the organization should have such access and to what extent? It is crucial to know who you're working from, their track record to complex strategy projects, to basic strengths and weaknesses. Talk to other people in the organization who have worked with them to gain more information. Vet people to avoid surprises and to understand the best ways to support and motivate team members. How much of your strategy is confidential? What can or should be shared with other groups. Set the boundaries and share them so that everyone agrees and has the same expectations. Make sure that the inner working of the group matches the culture and values of the parent organization. If your company is a free-floating as Google, you don't bind people with conservative rules that eliminate communal sharing of ideas and development innovative solutions. The second element is decision-making. The way that decisions are made in organization determines how ideas are generated and which ideas are considered. The way decisions are made influences how these ideas are carried out later. In this regard, before you register your company, you should be aware of the values with which your organization should be associated. This will give you a long-term idea on how should you operate. The third element is the idea generation. How ideas are generated affects the quality and quantity of these ideas, which directly affects the number of viable strategy options. So, this is another thing you should have in mind, as you should think about whether the idea is going to be generated only in your own head, or this again is going to be discussed in the large group and then set up the boundaries. The fourth element is the process. The process is the way that ideas are handled and consumed within organizations. Process defines the way the agreements and commitments are made and managed, and how well people understand what is happening and what to do. The fifth and the final element are people, but you should have in mind they are not less important. In an organization of any size, people bring their domain knowledge, talents, and perspectives to strategy creation. Often people are viewed as the first point of strategy failure, but they are actually the last point of a failure in a long-term series of cascading interactions. So what actually makes the strategy useful and why it is essential for your company? Well, without a strategy, an existing business can drift away from its customers and become uncompetitive within its environment and eventually stop making profit. This is known as a strategic drift. Therefore, having a strategy is a way to remain competitive or a way of forcing a strategic change when an organization has drifted away from its environment and is starting to fail. In general, the strategy is essential for operating and competitive market. As it was previously explained, the origins of the term have military and warfare meaning. So, as for one commander, it's essential to know what is his goal and how he is going to build his troops, what kind of weapons he will need in advance. The same is valid for every business owner. In order to be competitive, he has to be aware not only of his own strengths and weaknesses, but for the capacity and ability of his competitors as well. Most small businesses have a strategy in the form of a business plan. This is usually a standard document generated to convince either an advisor or a bank they have a good idea and have thought about it. We recommend at least some SWOT analysis and financial forecasting within the business plan template. This type of strategic business plan is then used to secure funding from the stakeholders. More recently, strategic tools are being used in the creation of vision and mission statements to be communicated to the stakeholders. These have a number of uses. Firstly, to help sell the idea to a company, to its investors, to secure the resources for expansion. Secondly, the move to culture-based management, where the organization relies on its culture to inform the employees' choices, enabling them to make the correct decisions at all levels without strict supervision. The next document, which we are going to speak about, is the business plan. So, Before starting, we should be clear about what are the differences between the business plan and the strategy. Many business owners know and understand the value of a business plan. The business plan is a key component of the loan process and services as a foundation for your organization. However, it only tells half of the story. To get the whole picture and have a framework on which to build your business, you also need a strategic plan. First, let's look at the difference between a business and a strategic plan. In simple terms, a business plan covers the who and what of the business. The strategic plan gives the how and when. In broader terms, the business plan tells us who by showing us who is running the business, what makes them qualified, what do they bring to the table that adds value, who are the competitors, what do they have to offer and what makes you different, who is your customer, how big is the market, where are they, what do they want and how will you give it to them. Also, how will you connect with your market? Have you had these connections already or you need to settle them from scratch? The business plan answers the what by telling us exactly what the business provides and how they provide it. Product and service and operations are all explained so that we understand how the claims are being met and if business is run effectively. The strategic plan, on the other hand, lines out the following. How will you measure success? What metrics matter and how will you track them? What needs to happen so you can achieve your goals? What resources do you need to get there? When? When will each activity take place? Who will do it? And when do you need to reach specific milestones? In both cases, you need a team of players on hand to help you plan, develop, and execute both of the business and strategic plans. Remember, your business needs both to give it a clear foundation and sense of direction, as well as to assist you with identifying key players and resources to seek out and acquire. Without them, you're practically driving with the brakes on. The next topic which we are going to cover is what should one business plan contain. You should have a specific idea on this topic, as you may already know this is going to be your final assignment. The business plan is a detailed description of the actions you will do and how exactly you will do them. But there are some generally accepted conventions about what a full-blown business plan should include and how it should be presented. A plan should cover all the important materials that will contribute to making your business a success. This includes the following. Your basic business concept. This includes information about what goods and services you are providing. Second, your products and services and their competitive advantages. Here's your chance to dazzle the readers with good, solid information about your products or services and why customers will want to purchase your products and services and not those of your competitors. Third, the markets you cover. Now you have to lay out your marketing plan. Who will your customers be? What is your demographic audience? The background of your management team and key employees. Your financial needs. This will be based on your project financial statements. As you write your business plan, stick to the facts instead of feeling, projections instead of hopes, and realistic expectations of profit instead of unrealistic dreams of wealth. Facts, checkable, demonstrable facts will invest your plan with the most important component of all, credibility. Regarding the length of the plan, a useful business plan can be any length from a screw to the back of an envelope to more than 100 pages for an especially detailed plan describing a complex enterprise. A typical business plan, however, runs 15 to 25 pages. Mini plans of 5 to 10 pages are the popular concise model that may stand
on their own for smaller businesses. Larger businesses seeking major funding will often have mini plans as well, but the full business plan will be waiting in the wings. It's to your advantage to run long when creating your plan, then narrow it down for presentation purposes. However, when the time comes for you to write your own business plan, the pages shouldn't be your main leading indicator for detecting if you have said and described everything necessary. It is not the quantity that matters, but still you should bear in mind that if your plan is 2 pages, it's most probably too small, and if it's 50 pages, you probably need to remove some useless information. Generally, you should follow the main bullet of your structure and try to be as precise as possible. Even expenses for pencils should be included. But still,
the question remains of how should we detect and divide the good business plan for the bad one? By just stating that the business plan is good when it's working is definitely not enough. An increase in the company's incomes may be an indicator, but it won't be the only one. The time you save, the less worries you have from the unknown, and in general, the smooth work of your organization can be considered as more valuable options for measurement. However, the most essential thing is to measure if the plan fits your business needs. It is often the case when business plan is written perfectly, everything is described, and yet nothing to do with your organization incentive, which at the end makes it absolutely useless. Needless to say, if you are planning to open an NGO focused on environmental issues, a business plan including the closing of all enterprises which are causing pollution within a year would be rather unrealistic and overall useless. Another important thing to have in mind, one of the very important characteristics of a business plan is easy evaluation. In this regard, one of the ways to validate if your plan is good is to check if in the future you can measure all of your statements, budget, outputs achieved, and etc. If not, you have to rewrite it, being as concrete and numeric-based as possible. When you describe an action in your business plan, it must always be followed by a detailed description of who should be responsible for its implementation and for what. It is never one man's decision. When writing your business plan, you should communicate with your employees and colleagues, including them in the decision-making process. By doing so, they will occasionally be more dedicated to follow what has already been written. Furthermore, it will generate and guarantee that the tasks dedicated for each employee are feasible. Well, that was it for our today's session, and before I leave you, I should give you a small guidance about your final task, which is going to be to create your own business plan. Don't be afraid, this is nothing scary, I just need one short text from 4 to 5 pages, which is absolutely standard, and you should send it to me via email. I prefer to be sent it in a Word format so that I can correct it and send you feedback. As it is yet too early, we are going to discuss our deadline in the future, and I'm going to inform you in advance. As I have already said, this task can be done in a group or individually, and it's up to you to decide which of these options suits you best. For its content, you know that you can find different types of information on the internet about what should one business plan contain, and we already discussed that. But having in mind our limits, I want just to see generally what is your business idea and why you have chosen it. I want you to describe what types of funding you're going to use in order to establish it, what type of company is it going to be, what are going to be your customers, what are your competitors, are you going to produce goods and services. In terms of your production of goods, how you're going to transport them to your customers, what kind of expenses do you predict that you're going to have,
Have in mind that the information about which I'm asking should be only for the upcoming year. Don't go further in describing your plans for the next 30 years. I just want to see, according to you, what should be included and how you're able to capture all your ideas and implement it into a text. As you may have seen, there are no requirements for English, and I'm not going to be so strict on that. For me, the important thing is just to see your plan and idea. At the end, you should write me again briefly about how you're going to develop your business plan and how you're going to communicate with your employees once you have established it. Are you going to include your employees in your further tasks, or you're going to prefer acting solely? In this regard, it is also important to think about what kind of employees should you need and how should you find them. Are you going to find a university? Are you going to search for them in a website, or you're going to search for people via your family and friends? It's up to you. And the main importance of that task is just for you to see how these ideas of yours are structured in a text. There is nothing scary, and I won't judge you too harshly. And yet again, we come to the readings for our today's lecture. As you can see, again, the obligatory readings are the ones which are directly related with the writing of a strategy and a business plan. You should feel free to use them as guides when you develop your own business plan. As for the optional readings, the essential of entrepreneurship and small business management, and the judging a business by its cover, they are a little bit more scientific, and this is the reason why I have chosen them to be optional, and they are not, again, strongly related to the texts which we are coming through in our lectures, but I strongly recommend you to see how an article in a more academic sense it's looking like in this field. Once again, I am presenting you the sources which I have used for this lecture, if you are interested to go through them once again. And now I'm going to say to you bye-bye and see you on our third lecture. That has been for today's lecture. Please write down your questions, whether you have any, and write them to me, and I will try to answer them in our next meeting. Also have in mind to read the literature which has been given and to look for further information on the internet. I wish you a good day and see you next time.